All right, hi guys. We'll get started soon. I think we should wait a couple minutes and see if more people join in. But yeah, make sure to have your homework ready from last week. And yeah, we'll go over that. Okay, so it's 1:05, so we'll go ahead and get started. Welcome to week 3 of Python programming. So today we're going to go over for loops, if loops, while loops, and functions. Last week we did lists, slicing and tuples, and then 2 weeks before that we did print variables and data types. So this is our agenda today. We're gonna go over, or actually this is wrong. We're just gonna start with the review. This should be homework. So number one is homework. And then we're gonna do review, range function, and then go over for loops, if loops, while loops, functions, and then do a quick demo and maybe some practice problems if we have time. And then we also have homework this week. So let's go ahead and open up our homework from last week. Which I think is this, yeah. So you guys had 6 problems to do. These were solely based off of the slides from last week. So anything related to lists, functions related to lists, methods related to lists, or tuples or slicing, that was what this homework was on. So let's go ahead and get started. So let me open a new REPL. We'll just call this answers. See if it can go any slower. Oh, filter reconnect. This is weird. Let me see if I can. Okay, cool. So the first question was, use a list method to reverse this list. List one is equal to 100, 200, 300, 400, 500. So let's define this list. So we have list one is equal to the integers 100, 200, 300, 400. Okay. And we want to use a method to reverse the list. And then we want to check if it's actually reversed. So we're going to print out that list. So if you finished the homework from last week, put into the chat what method you use to reverse the list. You can also unmute if that works. Awesome. Okay, so Nitin and Lakshmi, both of you guys are correct. So we would use the reverse method. So we would just say list1.reverse parentheses, and this will reverse this given list. So let's run this. Yeah, so the elements are now in backwards order. Okay, so number two. Now use slicing to reverse the list above. So same idea, except instead of using a given method or a built-in method, we're gonna try and use slicing. So we have list one again, let's redefine it with this list. And then we do some slicing here and then we print out the list again. So what did you guys do for the slicing? You can put it into the chat or say it out loud. Print. Good. Okay. So Lakshmi, that's correct. So we could either, yeah. So we could either do it in the print statement. We could just say print list one, colon, colon, negative one. And if we do that, remember when we don't have any values between the first two colon, the first colon, the default is just the beginning of the list to the end of the list. So it's going to go through the entire list. And then the second colon, the number after the second colon, that's the step. So if we want to go backwards, we would have to use negative one or any other integer. If you want to do negative two, then you would go backwards by two. Does that make sense? So we can either print it out like this, but in this case, we want to reverse the list itself. So we would just redefine it as that reverse list. So colon, colon, negative one. And then we can just print that list. So that now list one is just the reversed list. Yeah. Okay, cool. Number three. Write a program to add items 7,000 after 6,000 the following list. So this question is kind of confusing. Basically, there's this 6,000 here. It's a list within a list within a list, okay? And we have this 6,000 here, and we want to add 7,000 here at the end of 6,000. So that means that we would have to do multiple brackets in order to append that value. So lists. Let's try this. So if I can demonstrate this to make more sense. So list 1, 0, this value is just 10. So this is equal to 10. And list 1, let's say 2, this value is this entire list here. So that entire list is the set or the third element inside of this list. So this would be equal to this list one. So we know that this list 2 is this entire list. And we want to get this list. So this is 0, 1, 2. This is the second index. This entire list is the second index. So we would say brackets again and then second index. And that would give us this list. Does that make sense? So put into the chat how you guys added 7,000 after 6,000. So for just a hint for this one, we would use a certain list method. There's a list method that we can use to add a value at the end of a list. Okay, so for this one, since we know that this list has this value, that's what it's labeled as, we would say a dot append 7,000. So if we say dot append 7,000, inside of that list, 7,000 will be added to the end of that list. So let's print out list one and see if it added 7,000 to the correct place. Yeah, so here we have the list 5,000, 6,000 was our original one, and then added 7,000 to the end of it. Okay, next question. Write a program to print out the value 20 from the given tuple. Tuple 1 is equal to orange list of 10, 20, 30, and then tuple of 5, 15, 25. So in this case, we need this 20 right here. So we have this tuple, let's define it. So tuple 1 of 0, 0th index is orange right now. I remember in Python, we can use either single brackets, double brackets, it's still a string. And then this index 1 is this list that we're looking for. So we say index 1, this would give us this list right here. So since we want the 20 inside of the list, we would have to do another set of brackets. So inside this list, 20 is index 1. So how would we would get this? We would say tuple 1, 1, and then 1 again. And this would give us 20. So we can just print this out. Yeah, so this is list 20. And is, okay, I can show you guys the error before. Does anybody know why this error is occurring when I run this? In the list, it was fine. But why is it in the tuple? It's not letting me do that. You can put it in the chat or you can raise your hand. So what does this error mean? Okay. So basically this error means that the tuple object, yeah, so you can't alter the tuple, or a tuple is immutable. Immutable means that you cannot change any of the elements inside of a tuple. You can't reassign them. So does that make sense? So when I say tuple 0 is equal to orange, in this case, I was just showing you guys that it was equal to orange, but Python thinks that you want to reassign this value. Even if it is the same value, you want to reassign it, and that doesn't work for tuples. You're not allowed to do that. So you can just comment this out. Yeah. So we got 20. Number 5. Okay. So define a tuple with 4 integers, 10, 20, 30, 40. Then write a program to unpack the tuple into 4 variables and display each variable on one line. So can somebody send me their code in the chat? And then I'll just define this tuple. So we have tuple 1 is equal to 10, 20, 30, 40. Remember with tuples, we set them off with parentheses, not brackets. Brackets is for lists. So does anybody have any idea how to unpack these four elements? Okay, so with unpacking, basically what we do is we just say, we just have 4 variables is equal to tuple. So in this case, we can say A, B, C, D is equal to tuple 1. So each element in that order would be assigned to each of the corresponding variables. So 10 would be assigned to A, 20 would be assigned to B, 30 would be assigned to C, and then 40 would be assigned to D. And then we can print these. And print each of these variables separately. So I think I went over this, or we mentioned it on the slides last week, but when unpacking tuples is really helpful when you're returning multiple items in like classes or functions. So we'll go over functions today, but basically when you define a function and you want to return something back to the user, to the console, or to use later in your program, then you can use unpacking to get each of those elements inside of that tuple that you returned. So let's run this. Yeah, so we have 10, 20, 30, 40. Okay, last question. Define a tuple with 6 integers, 11, 22, 33, 44, 55, 66. Write a program to copy elements 44 and 55 from the tuple into a new tuple. So for this one, we want to try and do this in 3 lines. So our first line is obviously the definition of the tuple. So we would just say copy pieces. Tuple 1 is equal to this tuple. And now we want 44 and 55 from the tuple. So anybody have any idea how we would use slicing to do this? Because we only want to do this in one line. We don't want to say tuple 2 is equal to tuple 1, comma, tuple 1 again. We want to do it in one kind of block. I'll write out the two words. So you can say tuple 2 is equal to tuple 1 something, tuple 1 something. So we can say tuple 2 is equal to tuple 1 something to something. So either way works. Which way would someone can put either way in the chat? Okay, so for this one, this first method, we're just saying that we want this certain element from tuple one to be the zeroth index in tuple two, and then another element to be the first index in tuple two. So in this case, we want 44 and 55. So that would be index 0, 1, 2, that would be index 3 and then index 4. So we would just say index 3 and then index 4. And then we can use slicing as well. We can say we want index 3 to 5, or because this is the last index is not included, that means 3 to 4. So that's just 44 and 55. But since the fifth index is the last index inside the tuple, we can also say negative 1, because that just means the same thing as the last element. So remember, when we have only one colon and we say negative 1 after that one colon, that means the last element. But if we have another colon and we say negative 1, that's the step. So we want to go backwards. That's what that means. So there's two different meanings to negative 1 in slicing. So in this case, we can just say 5. Or we can say 1. So all of these basically mean the same thing. Oh. So let's delete these or let's comment these out. Print our, oh my gosh, equal to. Yeah, so now our new tuple is 44 and 55. Does that make sense? Does anybody have any questions? Okay, so let's go back to the slides. Let's continue. Okay, so this is review. Hold on, give me one second. Okay, so this is review from last week. Again, we did lists, we did methods with lists, and then we did tuples as well. So with lists, remember, they can store multiple values and you use square brackets to set them off. And list items are ordered. So the order does not change in a list, no matter how many times you access it or redefine it. And also, they are mutable, which means that you can change the items inside of a list. You can like add, if you have an integer, you can add one to it, or you can reassign a different value to that index in the list. They also allow duplicate values. And when you want to access items in a list, it's the same index as accessing a certain character inside of a string. So it works the same way. You start at 0 and then you keep counting by 1, same as in a string. And then if you want to check if an item exists inside of a list, use the in keyword. And yeah, here is an example of slicing. Useful methods for lists, we have insert a new list item, and you don't replace any of the existing values. Append, you add an element to the end of the list. Extend is appending elements from another list to a current list. So basically just joining two lists. Remove and pop. So remove is a specified item as the argument. So in this case, if you had a list of strings and you want to remove a string that's set off by quotes that says like banana or something, you would say remove in parentheses, you'd put banana, and that would remove that item from that list. Pop is opposite or different from remove in that you would specify the index of the item that you want to remove and not the item itself. And then it just removes whatever item is in that index from the list. We have sort that sorts the list alphanumerically. So we didn't go over this, but basically each character has an ASCII value. So you can search this up. I'll put it into the chat. Every character has an ASCII value. And so it sorts based on the number it corresponds to, that value corresponds to, or character, whatever. And then slicing is how we extract subsequences from a list. And then last but not least, tuples. You can also store multiple values in tuples. You use parentheses to set them off. Tuples are ordered and they're immutable or unchangeable. So we went over that. You cannot change items inside of a tuple once it's defined. You can convert a tuple to a list if you want to get around that by using the list keyword. So we just say list in parentheses and the tuple, and then you can change whatever you want and then convert it back to a tuple using the tuple keyword. And then you can extract values back into variables or unpacking like we showed before. And then you can add in like asterisks if you want the rest of the variables or the rest of the values inside of a tuple to be assigned to one of the variables. And that would just make a list of those values. So if this makes absolutely no sense, you can look at the slides from last week. And I think the video is coming as well. So to refresh your minds, or if you're confused at all, or you can always ask us in the chat or unmute, anything works.
Okay, so now we'll be going into some new material. So first we'll be discussing range. So essentially, range is used in a for loop to create a list of integers through iteration. So what is outputted is an arithmetic sequence with a common difference between each of the numbers. So the syntax of range would be range and then parentheses, start, comma, end, comma, step, parentheses. So start means the starting number, and then end means the number that the sequence ends before. So when you say end, it means that it won't include that last number. It will end before that number. And then step is essentially the common difference between each number. So some shortcuts include range 10. So this would be the same as range 0, 10, 1, which would print an out a list from 0 to 9, since 10 is not included, and it iterates through the list using 1. And then range 5, 10 would be the same as range 5, 10, 1. Again, it iterates through the list with increasing by 1, and will print a list with numbers 5 through 9. Because 10 is not included as it is the end number. And then now for loops. So for loop, like in the name, is essentially a loop of code. So it allows for you to repeat a certain block of code instead of continually writing that piece of code. So this is essentially like easier way to write repeated code. It iterates through lists, like we said, using the range function. Arrays, strings, and range. And lists are, like we said in the previous lecture, are a sequence of objects with any data type. So the syntax would be like one syntax would be for var in iterable. So essentially this means for an item in a particular list or tuple or string, that's what that first statement is. And then it var would be like each item iterated one by one in the list. And then you indent, and then the particular statements follow. This is called the loop body. And so this is executed once the first statement passes. And yeah, that's basically it. And then if loop. So if loop is a different type of loop. It's a decision-making loop. So essentially what happens is that it is a particular statement that outputs true or false. And if in an if loop, if the expression is true, then the statements within the if loop are executed. Otherwise, if it is false, you go on to the following statement after the if loop. In an if-else loop, so if the if expression is true, then the statements in the if loop would be executed. However, if it's not true, then the else would be executed and the statements under that would be run. And then the if-else loop. So essentially, else if is like a combination of if and else. It's like else is like a final statement, and you don't really need an expression after an else statement. But an if else is saying like if expression doesn't work, then go to the if else if statement. And if that the else if statement has another expression that will go to true or false, and based on that, run the following statements. But if the if else statement is also false, then you run the statements under the else block.
Yeah, so let me show you guys an example, because we don't have if else or if else on this. Okay, so this is just an example of if, elif, else, and if, else. So this if, elif, else statement basically is checking this first statement. You're saying if room, or this variable room, is equal to kit, then you print this out. But if it's not equal to kit, then you would go to the next elif statement. So you would say elif room is equal to something else, then print this other statement. And then if it's not equal to any of these, then go to this else statement. So any other value would print out this. And this is an if-else statement. So like, if area is greater than 15, print this. If that's not true, do the else statement. So any other value that's not greater than 15, it would go to the else statement. It would print pretty small. Okay, while loop. So while loop is basically a loop that executes a number of times before terminating. And the difference between a while loop and a for loop is that a while loop has a condition statement and it will continue to run until that condition statement is false. So while a while statement is true, it will execute whatever code is inside of that while loop, and then it'll terminate once that statement is false. And you can replace it with a for loop using a range function, but while loops are just easier, or they can be used in different cases in case you want like a condition to be satisfied, or you don't know how many times the for loop will run. You don't know that value, so you can just have a while loop to run and as many number of times until a condition is false. And the reason why you should be careful with while loops is that if your condition never becomes false, it's always true, you're going to have an infinite loop. And so basically your while loop would just continue to run and it would never stop, and you could crash your computer. So make sure with condition statements that it will become false at a certain point of time, or the condition will become false. It won't always stay true. And so this is an example of the syntax of a while loop. You have while, the while keyword, and then the condition statement. It doesn't have to be in parentheses, and then colon, and then whatever statements you want the code to execute. And so here again, this is just how the while loop works. It starts off with the condition, and then it says if a condition true, do this code, and then go back to the condition. If it's false, then exit. But if it's true again, then you keep doing the condition code. Okay, so defining functions. So far we've been using a couple built-in functions like print, range, inputs. All of those are built-in functions, but we can also define our own function. So you would want to create a function, or you would use functions in cases when you have code that is reusable in order to do an action. So you don't want to keep writing the same code over and over again to do an action. You'd rather just define it to a function and then call that function. So in this case, you would create this function with a certain function name and then certain whatever like actions you want the code to do, and then it would return something back to you. And so you can call the function after you've defined it, and it provides modularity for your application. So this is a little more complex, but basically it allows you to have a lot of functionality when you have bigger programs that you want to use or that you want to make. So this is an example of a function. So use in case of defining a function, you would use this keyword def, and then you have the function name, and that can be any name. It's just and it follows the same boundaries as variable names. And then you have parentheses and then parameters. So functions don't necessarily have to have parameters. You can have just an empty function, like a function name, and then just parentheses, so it has no arguments. But in case you want to use certain values from your code that's user inputted or you input, you would have to have parameters. And then you can use those parameters inside this function to do something with it and then return it or something like that. So this thing is called docstring. Docstring is basically just good coding practice. It allows you to explain what your function is doing, why you even created a function in the first place. And then these dot, dot, dots, they're just for where your code would be, like whatever code you want to execute when you call the function. And then you return something at the end of a function. So you don't necessarily have to return something. It can just be like inside of this, you can just be printing something or something like that. You don't have to return it. But in most cases, you're doing something to the parameters or to a variable, and you're returning that variable or value back to the function. So you would have to assign that to a variable name. So we'll go over this. And so this is how you call the function. You say function name, and then in parentheses, you would put whatever arguments you need to have, or if you have zero arguments, you just say function name and then parentheses. And then it would call this function, and then it would go through the code. Okay, examples. So let's do this. So I'm gonna use this same, let me just delete this. Okay, let me get the examples ready. Give me 1 second. Okay, so let's go over for loops. So let's say we want the for loop to print hello 10 times. So how we can do this is we can say for whatever variable we want. So let's just say for I in range 10. So basically, it's going, remember when we have range, if we don't define a first value to start at, it's going to start from 0, and then 10 is not included, so it'll end up at 9. So it'll go from 0 to 9, and 0 to 9 is 10 values. And so each time this range increments, I would be assigned to that value. So in cases where you want to use that incremented value, you can use I inside of your for loop. Like you can say I, like print I times 2 or something like that. And it'll print that variable multiple times, like with each increment. So in this case, it'll print out I times 2 in range 10. and then it'll print out hello. So let's run this. Yeah. So it started off at 0, 0 times 2 is 0, and then print out hello, and then 1 times 2 is 2, and then hello, and then so on and so forth. And we can also increment a variable outside of a for loop. So let's say we have x is equal to 0 outside of our for loop, and we want to print x and then add 1 to x 5 times. So we would say for I in range 5, print x. Oh my gosh. Print x, and then x plus is equal to 1. I remember x plus is equal to 1 is the same thing as just saying x is equal to x plus 1. It's just a shorter way of saying that. So if we run this, you have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Does that make sense? So x is starting at 0, and then it's saying, okay, I is not is at 0, is now equal to 0. So when I is equal to 0, print x and then add 1 to x. So print x, 0, now x is 1. And then it says for now I is equal to 1. It's going to print x again. It's going to add 1 to x. So x is 1 and then it'll add 1. It's 2 now. So it'll keep doing that until it reaches 4 in this case. Okay. We can also increment through a list in for loops. So we can say for I in this list, 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. We can do something to I. So we can say, like, we can use I inside of our for loop. Like, let's say x is equal to I times 2 minus I minus 1. So this will give us an interesting value. And let's print x and then end it with this comma. So when we use print statements, there's a couple things we can do with print statements. We can use format. There's like a format option that we can do. Or we have this thing called end, and it basically says for each of the incrementing print functions, end it with this comma, don't end it with a new line. So instead of here, we have each print statement is printing it on a new line, it would end it with a comma instead, and the next value would be after that comma. So let's print this. Yeah, so we have this 1 comma 1 comma 1 comma. Does that make sense? There's also format. I can show you guys format. This one is more like you don't use this when you're like when you have multiple print statements. You use this if you only want one print statement. So let's say we have this like item apples. And we have like some amount of apples, which is equal to 5. And let's say we want to print this. I have some apples or whatever our thing is here. I'll just put in parentheses because that's what we want to print right now. And then I have amount apples. So in this case, instead of doing multiple print statements in order to add this value or like saying, like quoting this often saying plus or something like that. Instead, what we can do is we can use the format statement. So we can say, we can put, curly brackets in each of the places that we want our variables to be. And then we would say at the end of the string, inside the print statement, we would say dot format. And then in each of these curly brackets, it will put the value that we put inside of format in the order that we put it. So In this case, we want apples to come first in this curly bracket. So we would say item one. And then here we want amount. So then we would say amount. And then here we want apples again. So item one. And so when we print this out, yeah, so it'll say I have some apples dot I have five apples. Does that make sense? Everybody can see my screen, right? It's not too small. So like the same thing would just, like, we can say it the same thing by just concatenating each of these things. Say like I have some space plus item one plus dot I have space plus string plus space plus one. Like this is the same thing as this. It's just easier to write this full like string first and then just insert whatever variables we want into the curly brackets. So it's a much, much easier method than having to like figure out where to concatenate each of these variables in this string. Okay, if loops. We might not have time for examples today. Okay, so if loop, so let's say we have an input from the user and we tell them to input a whole number. So now we want to check what this whole number is. So we want to say if it's less than one, then print out it's less than zero. Or less than zero, sorry. If x is less than one. So if x is less than zero, and print out your number is less than zero. And then else print out your number is not less than zero. So let's run this, and there's actually something wrong with this code right now, and I want you guys to tell me what is wrong with this code. So let's input a number, -2. Okay, so why is it giving me that error? This is the important part, string and integer. Does anybody know what is going on here? It's getting the input from the user and then saying if it's less than zero, then say your number is less than zero. Why is it giving me an error? Okay, so basically it's giving us this error because right now input is a string. If we remember, input function will always give us a value of or data type of string, no matter what the user inputs. So in this case, -2 is a string. We can't compare if string -2 is less than zero because they're two different data types. So we would have to use the int keyword when we want the input to convert it into an integer. And then we can run this. So -2, your number is less than zero. And then let's try for something else. 5, your number is not less than zero, okay? And then we can also have an elif statement. So if we wanna check if x is equal to zero, we can say elif x is equal to zero. Print your number is zero. And then here, in this case, we can just say your number is greater than zero. Because any other value that's not less than zero is not zero, is just gonna be greater than zero. So let's run this and let's test out zero. Your number is zero. Oops, there's a comma. school period. Zero, the number zero. Does that make sense? Hopefully that makes sense for everyone. Okay, while loops and then functions and then, yeah, we won't go over examples or practice problems today. So for practice problems, just do it for homework along with the homework that is given on the slides. And I'll send the link in the chat as well. And then we'll go over the practice problems tomorrow at the beginning of class. So let's do while loops now. So let's say we want to say while the I is less than 6, print I and add 1 to it. So same idea. So you can say while I less than 6, I and I plus is equal to 1. So let's run this. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's incrementing until this condition is, in this case, false. And then it would then exit out of the while loop once it's false. So once I becomes 0 or becomes 6 or is greater than 6, then it'll exit out of that loop. So we can also, so does that make sense? And then remember to increment by I. If we incremented by a different value, like while x is less than 6, and let's define x is equal to 0. It's gonna be forever. And let's stop this. So does that make sense? So make sure you're incrementing by the same variable so that it actually stops, the program actually stops. Yeah, so the ML class is gonna start at 2. So we're almost done here, okay. And then let's go over function. So let's say I want the function to give me the area of a square when I give it its side length. So let's say, so we can do this by defining a function called square and then having a parameter called side length. So inside of this function, we would have some like sort of doc strings. We would say like, what is this function doing? It's returning the area of the square given its. So how do we get the area of a square? We would just do the side length to the power of 2 or the side length multiplied by the side length. In this case, we just say return side length, oops, power of 2. And so when we call this square is square, let's say we want, if the side length is 10, we would have to assign this to a variable because right, it's returning the area. So in this case, let's say area 10 is equal to square 10. And then let's print area 10. Ooh, wait, hold on. Okay. So it prints out 100. Does that make sense? So right here, we're calling the square function and the side length is 10 and it returns 10 to the power of 2, which is 100. And then that 100 is now stored in area 10 and then it's printed out to the console. Hopefully this makes sense. It's 155, so yeah, these practice problems are on the slides, which are in the document that I sent before. I can send it again. So this document has all of the slides from the previous weeks and this week's. And so do the practice problems and then the homework as well, which I can also send in the chat. And then we'll go over both on next Sunday. Oh, and let's delete these answers. Okay. So it's 1:57. Thank you guys for coming today. Hopefully it wasn't as confusing as we made it. And you guys sort of understood what we were talking about. If you have any questions, email us. I'll put both of our emails in chat. And yeah, have a good week. And the Python or the ML class is going to start in like 2 minutes. Thank you guys.
Hello, can everybody hear me? Okay, perfect. I'm just gonna share my screen and we'll get started with this week's machine learning class in a second. Do you just wanna share the screen or should I share it from my side?
I could share the screen for the slides and then you can do the demo.
Okay, sounds good.
Yeah.
Okay, just a sec.
Yeah, so we'll wait until like 2:05 and they get started. Some people might be late. Yeah. Okay, so it is 2:05. So we'll go ahead and get started. I'll just go over like quickly the table of contents for today, and then Rohit can take over. So today we're going to be learning seaborne. We're going to start off with distribution plots and then matrix plots, and then we're going to do categorical plots and then grids and style and then regression plots.
Okay. I think I'll just take over from here, but we'll first start with what exactly seaborne is, because obviously machine learning being really complicated, there's a lot of different tools you can use. So basically seaborne is a Python module or a library. Basically you can take seaborne and you can use commands that weren't originally in Python. It's mainly used for data visualization, so making graphs. Unlike other libraries that you might have heard of, like NumPy and Pandas, which are used to modify data or make it like look different or with different values, seaborne's main purpose is to turn those values into graphs, but you can't really change values with it. So a lot of things that seaborne is used for is like scholarly papers. In a background section, they might have some seaborne plots just to show a user exactly how the data is spread out. And yeah, seaborne, matplotlib, they're all basically used for, they're all basically different modules used for data graphing and data visualization. So we'll start with the first type of data visualization or a plot. It's called a distribution plot. So basically distribution plots involve having just showing the distribution of data over a certain interval. So in the case of this plot, you can see that it counts on the y-axis how many objects there are. And on the x-axis, it might be something like age, or in this case, I'm pretty sure it's earnings. So what it does is it'll take the amount of earnings of each person. Say someone earns like 10 bucks and then 11 and then 12 and then three people earn 13. It'll take those people and put them into different distributions. So say for example, we have to do a distribution plot of a classroom and it has multiple people who are 14, some who are 15, maybe three who are 16 and one who's 17. It'll basically take each of those categories and graph it for us. It's basically a bar graph. And it's actually a lot simpler than a bar graph because it's just showing the amount of things that like make up a certain category. Okay. So not only do you need to know the types of plots, but also how to code them. And it's actually pretty easy. Distribution plot, so dist plot. So SNS is usually how we import seaborne into Python. If you remember from a few weeks ago, you import other libraries, say NumPy and Pandas as NP or PD. So you do the same for seaborne, you import it as SNS. So when we call sns.displot, you can basically put in your data, say this person put in the data of a total bill, and it'll show you exactly the distribution of this bill. For example, it shows the percentage or the percentage of bills that say are worth $20 or $30 or $40. And overall, it's pretty simple. It just splits up the data evenly so that you can see exactly how your data is distributed. Okay. So the next type of distribution plot is a scatter plot. So unlike the first type of distribution plot, just a dist plot, this one involves distributing your data on a 2D level. It takes both total bill and tip. So if we look back at the distribution plot, it only takes in one example of data. However, the scatter plot takes two examples. It takes an x-axis and a y-axis. So it doesn't just count the amount of instances, but it graphs them based on another metric. So what this graph, for example, is showing us is as the total bill price increases, say we go from $10 to $50, the tip value also increases. As you can see, there's a general trend line that starts at around 0, 0 and ends around 50 and 10. So that's what a scatter plot does. It's really useful for finding trends between two different data types, because a lot of times we'll have really big data sets. So take, for example, like someone playing sports. They're going to have perhaps a salary and they'll probably have statistics about how they play in a game. So the distribution plot can only show us examples of their salaries or examples of how well they did in the game. But a scatter plot can take both of those metrics, say the amount of points they got in the game or the amount of blocks they got in a game, and they can weigh that against the salary. So we can see how effective a player is compared to how much we pay him. So it's really good for finding like rudimentary, like basic trends. Now to actually code it, it's really simple. You just type in sns.scatterplot. You put in your data frame, which you probably learned before, a data frame, whether it be a pandas data frame or a NumPy array. Then you put in your x-axis and your y-axis. And usually these two inputs will just be different columns that you use to like just graph. Okay, you can go to the next one. So this next one, the joint plot, is actually quite simple. It's just a combination of both the distribution plot and the scatter plot. So as you can see on the top, there's a distribution plot showing the distribution of the total bill. So there are more total bills that value around $15 to say $16. And on the right side, we see a distribution plot about tips. And we can see that the majority of tips were paid between the $2 and $4 range. However, in the middle, there's a scatter plot, which indicates a relationship between both the total bill and the tip. So all joint plots are is you take two different type of plots, a distribution and a scatter plot, and you basically put them together. So the thing about a joint plot, which is quite interesting, is that you can change exactly the type of graph that you can put in. And we'll get into different types of graphs later. But in the case of this joint plot, the code is quite simple as well. So first you type in sns.jointplot, then you put in the x value again, which remember is a certain column in your data frame. Then you put in a y value, which is another column. In this case, x equals total bill and y equals tip. Then the data would be maybe a restaurant, like a data about restaurants or how much they get paid for each bill or each tip. And the kind parameter means that you can change it from anything from a scatter plot to say a joint plot or a disk plot and any other types of like plots that you can use. Okay. Yeah, we can go to the next one. Could you just go back one? Yeah, thank you. The next type of plot is a line plot. So this is actually probably the simplest plot out of all of them compared to say a disk plot because it's just a line graph. Usually it involves data over time. In the case of this graph, it also mentions a time point because it talks about time, say over seconds or time over seconds or over minutes. And it basically shows us how this signal, whether it be the blue signal or the orange signal, fluctuates over time. Again, the syntax for this is quite simple. It's just sns.lineplot. Then, like mentioned before, x equals one column. In this case, x would be the time point column. Y equals another column, and in this case, it would equal the signal column. And then the data set, we would just put under the data parameter. Okay. So similarly to a dist plot, we also have something called a hist plot, which is not exactly the same, but has like similarities. They're from the same family of plots. As you can see here, it basically takes a range of values. If you look at this first column on the left over here, the very smallest blue column, it takes the bill length and portions it into a container from 30 to 35. That means for the density of 0.02, it fits within 30 and 35. So I'll take another example as well. If you look for the blue rectangle around the number 40, you can see that there is a much larger rectangle there. Because again, there are more values for this certain island, in this case, Torgersen, that go in this container between around 37 and 40. So a hist plot, rather than just having singular values, say 10, 11, 12, and counting the amount of times each occurs, it takes a group of values, say the amount from 10 to 12, and then turns that into its own data point. So a hist plot is actually much simpler, since all we need to know is just one condition or one data, or like one series of data. All we need to do is given one data point. In this case, it could be one column from a larger data set or data frame. In the example here, all we needed to give to create this hist plot is the data set and bill length mm. That's the only column that needs to be actually make this hist plot. So the, I can see it, but I'm good now. Now this plot, the pair plot, this is another type of distribution plot. As you can see here, it looks quite complicated because it involves scatter plots and dist plots or hist plots depending on the data. However, it's quite simple. All it does is it takes all the columns in your data set and creates correlative functions for each. Now, what does that mean? Now, if we look back at the scatter plot, remember that we had to put two columns in. We had to put an X column and a Y column in and then call the data. However, in the case of the pair plot, it takes all possible columns, in this case, bill length mm, def mm, flipper length mm, and body mass by grams. It takes all of these columns and plots out scatter plots for all of them. Now, for the columns that are the same, say bill length mm on the top left, matching up with bill length mm, all it does is it creates a dist plot to show us the amount of that column. So we'll take an example for the top column over here. So on the top left, we have the bill length mm column, and it correlates with the bottom bill length mm as well. Now, all it does here is it basically takes this column and turns it into a dist plot. It shows us that there are a large amount, around 55 of the bill length mm's that fall under the category of around 50. Now, if we take another example, if we go to the fourth column and the third row, we see there's a relationship between body mass grams on the bottom and flipper length mm on the left. As you can see, it looks somewhat like a straight line, and this is a scatter plot, indicating that as body mass gram increases from around 3,000 to 6,000, and as flipper length mm increases from 170 to 230, they are correlated, meaning that they increase at around the same time. So if you were to find a heavy body mass, they will probably have a larger flipper length as well. Okay. Now, as we near the end of the distribution plots, one of the final plots is a rug plot. So as you can see at the bottom, it's called a rug plot because of the so-called rug, which shows the distribution as a one-dimensional line at the bottom. Now, unlike, say, the distribution plot, which shows it to us in triangles, all the rug plot does is turn this into a smoother curve and, more specifically, creates a density distribution at the bottom. As you can see here, as the curve increases, the orange at the bottom gets darker, indicating that there are more things there. So if we were just to look at this rug at the bottom, we could easily determine exactly the density of this plot. There are more items around the number 20 as compared to, say, the number 40. And there are virtually no items around the number 0. So a rug plot is basically a simpler way of looking at a histogram or a distribution plot. Now, the final plot is actually a KDE plot. Basically, a KDE plot is similar to a rug plot, except it takes a little bit more, it takes more complicated values in. It uses a Gaussian distribution plot, which is a type of distribution, and a kernel density estimator, which is another type of distribution, and uses it on each of the data points. All you have to know from this plot isn't the fact that it creates these distributions, but the final result turns into something similar to a rug plot. If you look at the side here where it says density, all that refers to is the amount of times a certain value or instance occurs. And that's all this plot does. We don't have to worry about the complicated distributions at the top, but just that it creates a very nice visual for everyone looking at it and basically a smoother distribution plot. Okay. So distribution plots basically show us the distribution of data, say across a certain interval, but a matrix plot is different because it shows it to us in a 2D, it shows correlation in a 2D way. Now, there are not many matrix plots, but the main one I'll be going over is the heat map. So the syntax for this is sns.heatmap, and you can put in any data of your liking. In this case, the person who put in the data put in something related to a month and a year, and perhaps had a certain value increase and decrease over time based on the month and a year. It visualizes data with different gradients. So if we look over here, we can see at this heat map that instinctively the darker areas seem to have more activity. And if we look at these darker areas, it seems that in July and August of 1960, that's when there was the most activity for the certain graph. If we look at other areas, say January of 1949, there was a lot less activity. Now, this is a very neat way of finding small trends in your data, especially considering that with big data sets with say 600 to 700 data points per month, it might be hard to actually determine where the trends lie. So some key tips that you have to consider when looking at the heat maps. First, one major issue is that if you want to use ratios rather than actually counting, say, up to 600, we can use something called data.corr or core. It stands for correlation. All that does is it takes the two values, say the amount of times or things that occur in July and the amount of things that occur in 1960, and finds a ratio. For value-based heat maps, rather than dividing things and just taking a raw value, say 600, we can use something called a pivot table. All we have to do is say data frame dot pivot table. We put in the values. In this case, the value would have been this data frame, the index, and then we finally put in our columns. In this case, the columns would have been year and month. Okay. Now, while that is the only matrix plot, the next type of plot is perhaps one of the most important, especially when we deal with larger amounts of data, and that's categorical plots. So the first type of categorical plot is a bar plot. A bar plot, or the syntax for a bar plot, is X column name, Y column name, and then data frame name. Something similar about Seaborn throughout all types of plots is that they have the same exact syntax. If we look at other plots, it's usually X, Y, and then data. For the bar plot, it basically takes one bigger example of data, in this case, the gender or sex, and then splits it up into another type of data, or basically splits it up into another type of value. In this case, since the gender can either be male or female in the case of this data, it splits it up based on that. Then it aggregates this data off the mean. All that means is that it takes the mean value of this data occurring in the data set and then graphs it for us. This would be different from our next type of data, the count plot. In the count plot, rather than just taking the mean value, say in the previous plot, we could take the mean value of the ages of the males. In the count plot, we just count how many males there are. That's why the count plot has a much higher value of around 160, while the bar plot ended maybe around 20. It's a different syntax for the count plot. Because the bar plot has to do with another type of value, like age, the count plot only counts the raw amount of each value. For example, in the syntax sns.countplot, under X, we would just put the column name sex. And then under the data, we would just put the data frame name. In this case, this data frame is called the Titanic data frame. It's similar to a bar plot, but like I mentioned, only gives a value count instead of aggregating. So the next type of plot that we can be looking at is a box plot. Now, many of you might have actually done this in school, depending on your grade level, but a box and whisker plot is similar to this in the sense that it has lines that represent the median, the 25% quartile, and the 75% quartile. To clarify, if we look at this blue, if we look at the very left and look at the blue box and whisker plot, the box in the middle, the bottom line represents the 25th quartile, or 1/4 of the values and where that number ends. The middle line in between the box represents the median, or if we arrange the data from least to greatest, the very middle value. And then the final line on top of the box represents the 75th quartile. Or if we were to arrange the data from least to greatest, the value that would be greater than 3/4 or 75% of the other data. Finally, these other two lines on the top and bottom represent outliers, or where the majority of the data ends. Now, when it comes to the box and whisker plot, we can either take individual columns or we can do entire data frames. In the case of this plot, we took the tips dataset, which basically finds the amount of tips over a certain period of time. And we basically just took 4 days of the week, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and we did a box and whisker plot, the money people paid per their entire dinner or a total bill. This would show us that overall, a day like Sunday might have more people paying higher prices because the box is higher up on the graph than compared to other boxes. Instead of just doing one column, say days on Thursday and total bills, you can use an entire data frame and it'll create multiple box and whisker plots based on category. Now, the next two plots are quite similar to the box and whisker plot. First is the violin plot. Yeah, the violin plot is similar to a box and whisker plot, except like we looked at the rug plot before, creates an even and curved distribution that the box plot does not. The middle white dots here represent, as the box plot did before, the median. And the syntax is exactly the same. It's X column name, Y column name, and then data. In this case, X would be day, Y would be total bill, and our data frame is called the tips data set. Now this graph uses thickness or the size of the graph, length or the actual, rather than the length or the boxes and whiskers to determine the actual distribution of this graph. We can see, for example, that the Sunday violin is a little bit higher than say the Thursday violin, which shows that the distribution of values or the amount of money being paid on Sunday is most likely going to be higher. As mentioned before, if you remember the KDE plot or the kernel density estimator plot, it uses the same type of Gaussian distribution to make these curves or to show that there's an increased distribution on one end as compared to the other. Now, the final example of a categorical plot is the strip plot. Again, it looks similar to the box plot and the violin plot, but you could say it's a cross between the box plot and the scatter plot. It takes each type of data, say the amount of restaurants or people dining on Thursday and Friday and Saturday, and aligns them based on the amount of money they paid. In the case of Thursday, they paid around $20. And in the case of Sunday, it was up to more. No, in the case of Thursday, it was around, say, $12 to $13, where the majority of people paid. And in the case of Sunday, that number jumped up to around 17 to 18. As you can see, there's an increased density of dots where it's 17 to 18 on Sunday. Now, this is supposed to make your scatter plots, in a sense, categorical and also a lot easier to read because you can basically see how scatter plots interact based on different days. Now let's go to how to edit different types of seaborn plots and how to make them either look better or have more of them together. And that's the fourth part of this lecture, the grids and style. Now, for a quick overview, for grid type plots, this is a very small portion of seaborn, but it might be the most helpful because it can overlay different types of graphs. If you remember the joint plot from earlier, it used two types of graphs, it used the disk plot and the scatter plot to make a graph. However, grids are a lot more powerful. We use the first type of grid, the pair grid. As you can see here, it takes a scatter plot and basically shows the correlations between different types of flowers. In this case, the data is under the name the sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. As you can see, for each of these different graphs, you can associate, say, the fourth graph on the first row with sepal length on the y-axis and petal width on the x-axis. However, if you look in the middle, in the very diagonal row, in the middle diagonal, you can see that there are all straight lines. This is because the graph is graphing the same column against itself. If you look at the very bottom on the left column, you can see that the variable in question is sepal length. And if we look at the top row on the very left, it's also sepal length. That means that this graph is graphing the sepal length in relation to the sepal length, meaning that since these values are the same, this graph becomes a straight line. The same can be said for the sepal width graphing in relation with the sepal width, and the petal length and petal width being graphed respectively. You can in fact change the type of data set or plot that you use. In the case of the syntax is sns.pargrid. Then we can take any sort of data frame. In this case, we took a data frame relating to flowers. Then we took the variable name, in this case, sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width, and then mapped it using a scatter plot. We can change this map function to be a dist plot, or even to be a dist plot, a joint plot, or a line plot. The next type of grid is a joint grid. Now, if we remember the joint plot, it had a scatter plot on both sides, and the joint grid is pretty much the exact same. You basically input X, which in this case is bill length, Y, which is bill depth, and then you put in the data, which in this case would have been something about birds because of bill length. Then we can see a dist plot on the top and on the right, and a scatter plot in the middle, showing us that they're not really that correlated, but they do have somewhat of a relation in some clusters. The final type of grid will be a facet grid. Now, in this case, the data frame that we used here is the tips data frame, where we looked at the gender of those taking out, say, lunch, dinner, or more importantly, on different days. And we saw if there's a correlation with the tips that restaurant owners and their consumers received. In this case, the syntax or the way we use the code is very simple. It's sns.facetGrid. Then we put in our data frame, which in this case is tips. We put in the column, which is the amount of tips they receive, and then the row. We put in the column, which in this case would be, I believe it's lunch. We put in the row, which would be the gender for male and female. And then after that, we use the map function along with another column, in this case, total bill or tip, to create this grid. To repeat, for sns.facetGrid, you take the data frame. In the columns, we put the lunch or time data set. In the rows, we put the gender or sex column. And finally, in order to map this, we'd use other variables, including total bill and tip, to create these scatter plots. Now, finally, to editing your data sets and your graphs. Now, while these graphs may not have looked the coolest, especially considering that they were majority just blue and white, you can actually change them quite easily using set style. So if we type sns.setStyle and we put in the words white, if we put sns.setStyle white, it basically makes the entire graph in a white shape. If we look at graphs prior, they might have had a blue background, but that goes away. Some more examples include sns.setStyle and we put the word ticks. This adds tick marks to the graph where they weren't there previously. sns.dspine removes the lines from our graph. Next, we can use another sort of library, the matplotlib library, to change the figure size of our graphs. While graphs may have a set size according to our default settings, if we do plt.figure and we put fig size equals a certain number, say 10, 2, it makes the width of our graph 10, the height 2, and thus resizes the graph. As for sns.setContext, it takes different types of other examples. Say, for example, the scale. If we want to make a graph more zoomed in, we can change the scale. If we want to make the type or the font different, we can change that as well. sns.setContext is made for terms that aren't usually put in, don't usually have their own codes. Now, the final thing that we have to go over is regression plots. Now, these plots are perhaps the most important when doing machine learning tasks before you get started with the actual machine learning. The main plot we'll go over today is the LM plot. The syntax for this is sns.lmplot. You first put the x value, the y value, and then you put in your data. Again, if we look over here, although the data is a little blurry, we can see that it is from our tips data set, which takes the total bill and the tip and correlates them. Could you go back one slide? Yeah, thank you. Regression plots actually visualize patterns. So if you looked at the LM plot, we can remember that we saw a line in that scatter plot. It means that we can see a trend as, say, the amount of tips increase, say, as the total bill increases. If you want to use machine learning to find patterns, you're well off knowing these patterns before you go searching for them. As we looked at the LM plot, we saw that there was a pattern between the day of the week and the amount of tips that people received. If we decide to do a machine learning task with that, all that means is we can use our data and tune it towards this trend because we already know it's happening. Okay,
so we'll go ahead with the demo. Rohit, you can share your screen.
Yeah, sorry, it's just, okay, I'm good. Can you guys see it? Perfect. So we'll get started with the first type of plot that we went over. And before we do that, we need to import all our libraries. So in the case of Seaborn, all we need to do is import Seaborn as SNS. We'll also make sure to import all the other libraries that we've learned from the past. We'll import NumPy and pandas as NP and PD. And finally, we'll import matplotlib.py as PLT. So once we've done that, these are basically all the libraries and thus all the outside code that we'll be using for this project. Now we need some data to actually show how the data set works. In the case of Seaborn, we'll be using the data frame that I've been referring to quite a lot, the tips data frame. So for that, we'll do tips equals pd.readcsv, and I'll send you guys this link. Oh boy.
Yeah, I can put it in the chat.
All right, perfect. Thank you. Okay. So all we have to do is do tips equals pd.read_csv. We put one parentheses, the double quotes to represent a string. And then if this would just let me scroll right here. Then we just copy paste the link. We end quotes and then we end the parentheses. And if we run this code, it should basically create a data frame under the variable tips. I'll just give everyone a quick minute to do that and then, or just to like make sure you got this and then we'll go to the next step. Now first, we'll create the first type of plot that we were talking about, sns.displot. If we remember, the displot, as mentioned by the name, shows a distribution. In this case, we'll show the distribution of the amount of tips we have. Before we get started, let's first see exactly how our data frame looks. If we remember from before, we can basically use the head function to see all the columns and look at the first 5 rows of our data set. Now that we can see that we can use perhaps total bill or tip to make numerical assumptions, we'll do sns.thisplot. Then we'll take in our data frame tips and we'll use the column tip. This will be taking the tip column and showing us the distribution or the amount of values that occur between each that occur for the tip. So as you can see here, the amount of tips that occur are nearly around the $2 to $4 range. And it tapers off as we go down to $6 to $8 to even $10. Now, this is a very handy function to be to see basic trends. The next function that we'll be using is the scatter plot. This is the second distribution plot. Again, the syntax is very simple. SNS.scatterplot, data will equal tips. Then we have to input our column, so the X and the Y. In this case, if we want tips, or if we want total bill to be the X value, we'll just type in total underscore bill, which is this column. Then we'll take tip, and we'll type it in the Y column. That gives us a scatter plot that shows us the data points in this data set. And as you can see, as the total bill increases, as we see these dots go to the right, the dots also go up, indicating that the tip is also increasing. So next we have the joint plot. I'll just type this out over here. If you remember, the joint plot, as indicated by the word joint, is combining both the scatter plot and the dist plot. First, we'll type in our X value, total underscore bill. Then the Y value, tip. And finally, data, which equals tips. This creates a scatter plot in the middle that we saw up here, but it also creates a dist plot that we saw for the tips values up here and for the total bill. So as you can see, if we first look at the top, the total bill values range from $10 to $20 at most. And for tip, it ranges from $2 to $4. Now they've decided to take that data and show us a trend line. Next up, we have the line plot. Now the line plot is probably the simplest one out of all because it's a basic line plot showing over time. In this case, we'll use size as our line plot. X will equal size, Y will equal total bill. And remember that size is the amount of people at the table and data equals tips. So as you can see, as the size increases, so does the total bill. And that's logical. If we have more people at the table, more people will be paying. So that's what the line plot shows. We can do this for any other type as well. Say we want to do tips. We can, oh, my bad. We can see it's a much less common trend, but you can see that generally as the tip value increases, the total bill value also increases. The next distribution plot that we have is the hist plot. Again, we only need one data, unlike the dist plot or similar to the dist plot, we only need one source of data. In this case, we'll just use tips itself. And what will happen is we'll see a distribution of, say, total bill that we saw up there, or tip, which we also saw. In the case of size, which is 2, 3, or 4, it will also show a distribution. However, it does not show the distribution for something like sex, smoker, or day, or time, because these aren't numbers. The next plot we'll be going over is the pair plot, which, if you remember, is similar to a grid because it shows us different types of grids all together in one. Again, all we need to do is just show one, is we just need to show one data frame or one data set. We put it in the command. And okay. Okay. So if we look at this grid, it takes different columns. In this case, it can only take three numerical columns of total bill, tip, and size, and uses them to make different grids. remember in the diagonal, it'll use a distribution plot because it's graphing the same value against itself. However, for the values, say tip and total bill being compared, it uses a scatter plot. Next, we'll be going over the final type, or the second to last type of distribution plot, the rug plot. This one is also quite simple. It's just x.tip, which in this case would be our column, and the data frame would be tips. When we run this, we see that there is a small rug at the bottom, and that's exactly what we were looking for. Now, later on, we can add different types of plots as well. If I want to add a KDE plot, I can do so by writing, if I want to add a KDE plot to this graph, I can do so later by editing this graph, like we did in the last section with grids and style. But right now, all we're focused on is that little rug at the bottom showing the density or the amount of tips that we receive. The final plot that we'll be going over for distribution is the KDE plot. If you remember that complex Gaussian distribution and looking at those different distribution plots, this is what that turns into. If we take any column, either total bill or size or tips, we'll do tips for now. And we put in our data as tips. We can see exactly how the graph is distributed. There again, like we've mentioned time and time again, are more tips around the dollar values of 2 and 4. As it goes higher to 6, 8, and 10, the amount of tips that are that expensive decline. Now, the next type of plot we'll be going over, if you remember, is the bar plot. Again, it's similar to, say, a disk plot, but instead of just showing the distribution of values, it gives us, you give in one value and it gives you a weighted average or mean. In this case, SNS.barplot, and we have to put in two values. X will be tip, Y will be total bill. And data will be tips. Let's see if this clip we can make this easier to read. Okay, I can actually explain this. So basically what this is doing is it's taking each value of tip and comparing it with the total bill that it's related to and seeing if there's a difference. Let's see if we can actually change this quickly to size. That might be easier. Yeah, all right, this is a lot easier. So in the case of this bar plot, it's showing us the amount of total bill or the average total bill paid per each size. Take for example, size 1, which means one person, or size 6, which is 6 people. As we can see, the size or the amount of people or the amount of money paid for one person is a lot less than the amount of money being paid for 6 people, logically because 6 people need more food than one. We can use this bar plot in other ways as well. If we take size and we perhaps do tip, we can see that the same thing applies. As the amount of people increase, the tip increases, although there is an anomaly where the tip decreases from 4 to 5. The next type of plot we'll be going over is the box plot. If you remember the box and whisker plot, which shows the different quartiles in data, it's quite similar to that. First, we'll do x equals sex, which in this case is gender. And, or at least in the case of this, is showing male or female, and Y equals total bill. Finally, data equals tips. As we can see here, it seems that females, in fact, pay less when it comes to males, either because they order less or they come in smaller party sizes. Although the trend or the reason of this trend is unknown, we can see that there is a distinct trend between female and males. We can do the same for this through a violin plot. We'll take the same exact data and we'll see exactly how it changes. Instead of doing tick, we will do, or instead of doing total bill, we'll do tip and see if there is a difference. As we can see here, the amount of tips paid is actually quite similar, with females actually paying a little bit more in tips usually as compared to males. Finally, we'll do the third type of categorical plot, which is a strip plot. In this case, we'll do x equals tip. Now, in the lecture, the strip plot was vertical, and you can change that using different types of parameters. Over here, if you look over, you can change it from orient to none, true or false, or make it vertical or horizontal. And there are different other ways that we can change it as well. In this case, we can just take orient, which is another parameter that we can come up with on our own. We can change it to V, which should make the graph vertical. Okay. I'll just change it back. Yeah. Okay. Now the final example. Oh wait. Okay. Now we'll quickly go over the other types of plots that we have, which is a grid plot. Now a grid plot takes multiple data frames and uses different columns to find a correlation between them. For a grid plot, it's actually quite different because we first need to save the grid into a variable. In this case, we'll do pair grid and we'll make it the data equal tips. Next, we'll map this and we'll use the function sns.scatterplot, which is a scatter plot we used earlier. As you can see, it creates a scatter plot for each of the different columns. In the case of total bill, it'll correlate it with size using the scatter plot on the top right, or in tips and total bill on the first column. We can change this to whatever we want, a scatter plot. We can even try a box plot if we want to and see how that relates. This will take some time considering it's going to plot like 12 different plots, and all of them box plots. Yep. So as you can see, it did in fact take different box plots. And of course, it's very complicated because for some things like total bill and tips, box plots don't necessarily work. Now, finally, we'll go over the LM plot, which is another type of linear regression plot, which I mentioned earlier. The LM plot is simple. It's x equals LM plot, tip, total underscore bill, and data equals tips. It's quite simple. It just creates a linear regression line showing us a correlation for the scatter plot. Now let's see exactly how to change the different styles of this plot. Now let's take, for example, this LM plot. If we go up here and we type in sns.setStyle and we type in white like we did before, as you can see, it makes the background white and more importantly, changes the style of the graph compared to other ones. Can't find them. We can also do ticks. And this will add tick marks right there to show us the different types of the different numbers. Finally, we can do other things. Currently, this plot does not have spines, so it doesn't really matter if we take them out or not, but we can basically take out these background spines that may be used. Did not work. But with other types of graphs, usually this happens with line graphs more often than not, they will have spines or lines in the back that you can take out. So I believe that's it for this. If you guys have any questions, just let me know. If not, thank you so much for listening. And if you have any questions, again, like I said, let me know. There are also a lot of online resources you can use for changing the style of your graphs.
All right. Thank you, Rohit, for that amazing lecture. I'll share my screen again. Okay, cool. Yeah, so no homework this week again. Check the document for any announcements. And I'll put that in the chat as well. And yeah, have a good week, everyone.
Thank you, bye.
Hello. We'll get started in just a few minutes as everyone starts coming in. Yeah. Okay, I think we can get started as people start rolling in. Oh wait, we actually have 3 more minutes, so we'll just wait for a bit. Yeah. Okay, we have 1 more minute and then we're going to wait for everyone to join in, and then we can get started. Okay, yeah, it's just gonna be about 3 o'clock soon, so I think we can get started. So today we're gonna be talking about Flutter data structures and UI layouts. So yeah, we can get started. One sec, hide this. Okay, so what are we gonna discuss today? So today we're gonna be discussing about data structures and discussing the different types of data structures that can be used in Flutter. And then after that, we're going to briefly discuss databases and understand how we can store data on the user's device, or we can store it in a cloud database like AWS or Firebase. And finally, we can also talk about the UI layout components. the UI layout components. So we can talk about how we can lay out different types of widgets so we can use layouts to organize different types of widgets so that we can organize them and make it look like the way that we want to. And then finally, we're gonna work on creating our creative UI app, and we're gonna continue working based on the code that we used last week. So if you don't have that, don't worry, I'll have the solution code so you can use that and build off of that. Okay, perfect. So we can get started. So what are we gonna be discussing first? We're gonna be discussing data structures. So in Flutter, there are a variety of different data structures. So first there are numbers, which contain integer and boolean and double. And there's a boolean data type, which is just bool. And then there's a list data type, which is also commonly referred to in different programming languages as an array. So in Flutter, we refer this to just as a list. And then there's obviously string. And then there's this data type called maps, which is maybe some of you guys have used it. It's common in other languages like Python and Java, but you guys may or may not have used it. And this is where you have one data that has a label and then a corresponding data according to that. So if you want to say someone's birthday, so you'd say date and then a semicolon and then their birthday in like a string or whatever other data type you'd like to store. And then finally, we have these etc data structures in Flutter, which are the Flutter specific ones, such as late, final, and then constant, void, and dynamic. So I'll be discussing about these later in this presentation, but briefly I'll discuss about it right now. So late is, I talk about these later. We can go on. These are the basic data structures. And of course there are many more throughout Flutter if we use other packages from outside resources that you can check out on pub.dev, which is all the packages. So I can put that in the chat. So on this website called pub.dev, so just like that, this is a website that has all of the packages for Flutter. So all of these packages you can utilize in your Flutter programming when we actually learn it through the IDE rather than learning it through the website that Flutter has set up. So when we learn through the IDE, we can import these packages and really utilize their own specific ideas. And many of them use much more complex functionalities such as sign in with Apple, which is really using the Apple database. And there's a lot of different things that you can go on with that. And that's about data structures. And so, in Flutter, there's also objects. So it's much like any other object-oriented programming language where you can create objects to hold this data. So an example of this is if you want to hold user data, then you might want to hold the user data as a user's name, a user's birthday, maybe their last and first name, and maybe their like password. So all of these things you don't want to keep in just separate different variables, but rather you want to create an object that holds these variables. And this makes the code much easier and much easier to reuse as well, especially if you're creating a lot of different objects. In one of my apps that I created called Thank You, I created an object called a donation. And this is a donation tracker, so I have to keep tracking donations. So whenever a user inputs this donation, it creates an object of a donation, and then the user inputs different things, and those inputs are assigned to different variables. So an example would be the recipient of the donation. So who are you donating this to? So if I was donating to Goodwill, then I would say the recipient is Goodwill. So this is an example of how you can utilize objects and set things and make it much more easier to read. And of course, you can store this through objects through a local system. Like a very popular package is called Shared Preferences. And then there's also different packages, which I recently used called Hive, which is another great local database. And locally means that it stores directly on your phone. And it's not stored anywhere else and nobody else can access it except you. This makes it very, very powerful and very, very secure and safe because all this data doesn't really need to, it lives on your phone and it really doesn't need to be stored anywhere else, which makes it also very cost effective. Next, we'll be talking about asynchronous data. So what do I mean by asynchronous data? This means that when we have to wait for the data to load, we're going to use asynchronous data. So async is a special type of data type, a special type of, I guess, it's a specific word that we utilize to make sure that the app doesn't proceed with the task until the previous task is completed. So what do I mean by that? In our last timer app, if we go back to our last timer app, so let me open that one up. So if we go on the Google Classroom, this is today's. So if we go on the Google Classroom, if we go on the solution, we can see over here, we utilized async without even us knowing it.
We can't see that.
Oh, sorry. Okay, let me share my screen again. Oh, sorry about that. Thank you. Okay. Can you guys see it now?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Sorry about that. Okay. So right over here, we have this timer. And through this timer, we want to keep this data asynchronous. So what does this mean? We want to wait for this timer to be completed before the app does anything else. So in this section, we call the set state method, and we made it so that the app is rolling. And once it's done rolling, then only the app will complete its next task, which is maybe to refresh the screen or so on and so forth. Of course, in this app, it was very basic and we didn't really utilize async that much. But async is a very small, very strong property that we use a lot of times in methods. So we'll be using that a lot today as well. And we are using this to load our data and to proceed it forward. And this is really useful, especially when you want to load data for the first time into your app. So when you just open an app for the first time, a lot of times you see like a loading screen. And behind that loading screen is where the app is taking in the data from either their local database or their online database. And really, using the async property to wait for that data to be shown before they actually show you any UI changes. That's why there's a loading screen between different parts of the app. That's about it. So we can go into databases now. So databases are the second part of what we're going to be discussing today. So databases can be used for a variety of different applications, and it's really the integral part of your app. So a lot of times it's really important to choose this database properly, because we don't want something that's too expensive or maybe too weak, but we just want something that's perfect for us. This is where a lot of times that companies spend many months and years even designing the backend and understanding how to really get the most out of their backend and even creating native things. So we can really solve this as really important, and we need to keep in mind what kind of data we need to store and also the price point that we're going to be working with. And this is all really important part, and we usually refer to this as backend. So typically there are two developers or two sides of the development team in a big app. In an app such as Google Drive, there might be a UI team, which is the front end. This is the user end that we can navigate with. And there's also the backend, which is the place where we all store our data on Google Drive. So there are two sides of the designing, and that's really important to keep in mind when we're designing it just for ourselves and we don't have two people working on this. I think I had one more. Oh yeah, I skipped over one slide, my bad. So yeah, we refer to this as backend. And so we'll come across many different types of online backends. The most popular beginners for Flutter is Firebase. And there's also other backends such as AWS and MongoDB, which are different things that you can utilize online just to store your data online if you really need this for your app. So yeah, that's about it for backends. Next, we'll be going into UI layout components. So UI layout components. So to make complex and intricate user interfaces, we require more than just a simple layout of stacking things on top of each other. Rather, there are multiple components for layouts, but in this course, we'll only be using row and column. So in this course, row, as it suggests, can take in widgets and organize them horizontally. And then columns can take these and organize things vertically. So in our last app, we actually used this. So we used a column and we stacked all these things just vertically, right? There are two components. So there's this icon, and then there's also this gesture detector, which is the button that we created. So by stacking all these things vertically, we can see how we have it just perfectly vertically. But what happens if we change this to a row? Now, if we run it, yeah, it'll run. But yeah, if we run it now, we can see that now it's become in a horizontal form. even though the space is not there anymore because of it was just set as a height, we can see that it is truly, it's very versatile and very important to keep these things in mind. So I'm gonna change this back to column, but we can go back over here and we can talk about the other components. So this is done using a property called children, which takes in a list of widgets, and you can combine a lot of rows and columns to make even more complex designs. So over here, and a hands-on example that we did last time was with the same thing, we had the column. So once I run this, it'll change back to a column. And we can see that we pass in this property called children. And within this, we have a list of all of these widgets. See these three dots? This is a list. So we have this list of all of these widgets that we've included in here, all the way up this end bracket. So these are all the widgets that are included in this column. And within this, we can change the orientation by just editing row to column. Or we can even alter parts like the axis alignment. So if we want to align it to the right, to the left, maybe up over here, maybe we want to put it over here, we can change all that to the axis alignment. And yeah, that's pretty much it for columns and rows. So of course, there are many different components in Flutter, and there's like a ton of them. So that was just two of the ones that we'll be working with. But I really want you guys to go on this website, and I'll put it in the chat, which is the Flutter website. And I want you guys to check out all of these different components and maybe even play around with them in your own apps if you get time to develop them on the website. So we can see over here, we can use things like transform, we can use overflow boxes, and we can even use intrinsic heights. And of course, there are this is multi-child layout widgets, which is what we've been using. So we've been using a column and we've been using a row. But of course, there are things like list view where you can have like multiple things in a list. And then you can even have stack, which stacks multiple things on top of each other without having it directly one above on top of each other. And then, yeah, there's like basically a lot of editing that you can do and a lot of fine tuning that you can do to really make this your custom widget. So I want to talk a little bit about this specific UI layout. So as we can see over here, this is the UI that we've outputted. But to make this UI, we require all of these parts. And it's really important to understand what's going on here. So we can first start with this container. So this is the head, and this is where this is the entire container that's holding all these widgets. And then within this container, we have a row because we want to stack all of these things horizontally. But then within this row, we have three other widgets. So this is using the list property and the children's property to really put all these widgets in one row. And then finally within this, we have a column which contains an icon, so the call icon, and then a container that contains the text. So just think of this as one widget. But basically within this, we have a column and an icon, and then we have text right underneath that. So we can see how we can really utilize these layouts to create really complex and intrinsic layouts that really make the app look great. So this was obviously a little bit over-engineered, but this was just an example of what I was trying to talk about. And yeah, are there any questions? Okay, perfect.
I have a question.
Yes, of course.
So you might have explained this last class. I wasn't there, but yeah. Like if you want to upload like an icon, how would you do that?
So if you want to upload your own icon?
Or like your own icon or like any icon?
Or any icon, yeah. So icons, you can come over here and you can just search on the Flutter website. So you can search up icons. And then over here, you can see there's gonna be a list of all the icons. I don't know where it is, but so if you come over here, you can come to icon class and you can select whatever icon you want from over here. Or if you want, there's of course, you can download the icons from another website and you can put them into your app by importing like up through a package called icon. It was like icon data importer or something like that. So there's like different packages that you can utilize to really combine outside components and components that are within Flutter themselves. So here, obviously just like the couple thousand that Flutter has, but of course, outside of that, there's your own app icons and stuff like that you can really utilize and use it in your advantage. So yeah, that's a great question.
All right, thank you.
And I think I want to really quickly, briefly talk about a bit more about these data structures. So I didn't discuss much about etc. data structures. So sorry, this is kind of going backwards, but I want to talk about late and final and all these five data structures. So late is a great data structure because when we want to load data asynchronously, like we talked about, where we want to load data from a website or maybe a server that we're hosting something on, we can utilize late to make sure that the data is processed a little bit later. As the name suggests, late basically makes it so that makes Flutter understand that the data is coming in, it's loading, and it'll take some time to load it. Till then, if the late data has not arrived, then the screen might show something else, or it might buffer, or it might just show a loading screen as well. So these are things that we can account for by using if statements and even different loops that we can keep checking if the late data has arrived. Next, final. So final is a variable, and it's a variable that can be passed through different widgets. This is how parameters are made. So if we take a look at any of these widgets over here, all of these widgets have this variable of, we have this parameter, and this is a final parameter. This means that this parameter cannot be edited within the widget, but it can be edited outside of the widget and passed into the widget. So in this case, sizebox itself has no property or no way to change its size, but we, as using sizebox, has the way to change its height by passing in a height. So that's a little bit complicated, but essentially what final is, it's a variable type to pass data in. And then constant is a constant variable. It's basically a variable you cannot edit or you cannot change at all. And yeah, that's pretty much it. And then void is a return type. So it's not exactly a data type, but it's usually used in methods. And we can use this just as you guys might say, like you don't return anything. And then dynamic is a very important data type. So this is a dynamically updating data type. So you might be asking, why don't we just, dynamic updating variables are variables that might contain a Boolean 1 second and an integer another second. So why don't we just use this all the time? Well, it's really hard to keep checking these. And then in apps like maybe a counter app where we just want to keep incrementing the counter, do we really need a dynamic variable to keep incrementing it? Not really. A dynamic variable is really important and really useful when you have lots of data you want to import, but it just, you don't have that much data storage or you don't have that much RAM to really take in that data. So it's really important to keep in mind what you're using and really figure out what works for you. And yeah, I think that's about it. So we have a lot of time, so we can get started with the coding because it's a little bit more coding as well. And of course, I want to give you guys time to debug and work on the code yourself. So I'll send the, so I want you guys to open up the project from last time. I hope you guys saved it, or you guys can use the solution code from last time as well. So I put that in the chat. So those are the two options you guys can have. So you guys can either use whatever you made last time, or you can use the solution code. They should be about the same thing, maybe a couple of tweaks here and there. And yeah, we can get started. Let me share my screen and we can get started. Okay, so today we're going to be modifying this app, and I'll show you what we're going to be creating. So we're going to be creating something that looks like this. So we're going to be creating something that looks like this. So we're going to be creating a text random generator. We're going to be creating an icon random generator, so it changes to an icon or text, and then we'll be also doing both. So this is where both of them are involved, and then it randomly generates both of them. So this is what we're going to be working on, and this is really going to utilize our understanding of rows, columns, and overall layout structures in Flutter. So let's get started. Okay, and let me share my screen. So here was the code from last time. So we just have right now have this random icon, and when we push it, it generates a random icon. But now what we want to add are three more buttons right underneath that. So if we scroll all the way down over here, we can first see that we're gonna be stacking the widgets like this. So what I wanna do is actually, I'm gonna take a screenshot of this, and I want to, I'm gonna take a screenshot of the last project, and let me see, okay. Let me see if I can edit on the, oh wait, yeah, I got it. Okay. Okay, so here's a product that we're gonna be making, right? So I wanna really break it down before, and make you guys understand what layouts we're using in this project. So within the big project, we have a big column right here. So this is highlighted by the red. I'm sorry, my, yeah. It's highlighted by, oh wait, there's a, okay, perfect. There's a rectangle feature. Okay, so right in between this, we have a row right here. So in between this huge column, we have three major components. We have this one row, right? We have this one widget right here, another widget, and then finally we have a row. Within this widget, we have three other widgets, much like the one in the example, and how we have another column within this row. So this is a little bit, becoming a little bit complex, as you can see there are multiple boxes, but I hope you guys understand that this is really, I mean, this is really crucial to understand. So if you guys have any questions, feel free to speak up now instead of being lost a little bit later. So if we can see now, if we push the both button, so if we push both, this is actually a row. And within this row, we have two components. So it's really important to understand that and work with things as it dynamically update. Yeah, and that's about it. So I hope this makes sense a little bit. I'll leave the annotation. Oh no. Okay. Okay, wait, actually this works. We can do it this way. So let's first work. So we have all these components. So right now we have these two components and this big outside widget, right? Outside column. But within this big outside column, we want to add these other components. So to add the next component, we want to add a row, because this is a big row right here. Do you see this? Right here, a big row. So within this row, we have to add a property of children, because we want to pass in a list. So this is a list. We want to pass in a list of widgets. And then within this, we can see that we want to pass in these other buttons, right? So what can we do to create these? So we can create elevated buttons. So elevated buttons. So we can create three elevated buttons, okay? And it automatically shows us that we need the onPressed parameter. So we can add an onPressed parameter. And then right after that, we can press, we can add a child parameter, because it says over here, we also need a child parameter. So we need a child parameter as well. So so right now we're not gonna deal with what's gonna happen when we press it, but we're gonna work on the child. So this component right here, I actually want you guys to spend 5 minutes, and I want you guys to look at both the diagram on this presentation, and I want you guys to work on building it like this, okay? So right underneath this, we have all the stuff that we should, you guys have all the components that you guys should need to build this button right here. So right here, I'll describe it a little bit. So it's a column with an icon, and then there's inside of that column, there's an icon and a text box. So there's gonna be two widgets inside this column. So I want you guys to spend next 5 to 7 minutes. I'll give you guys until 3:30, so that's 7 minutes. And I want you guys to try to build this one component by yourself. Trust me, it's gonna be really hard, but I think you guys got it. So use stuff from previous classes, use stuff from this code, and just go for it. If you guys have any really big questions, just feel free to DM me. And yeah, can I scroll down to the code? Of course. So here's the code that we just wrote, just this little bit. And then right in this child property, I want you guys to build, remember that button that I showed you over here? I want you guys to build that button right there. Or the contents inside of that button. Yeah. And yeah, you guys have like 6 more minutes-ish. Yeah. Let me know if you guys need any help. Did anybody get it yet, or do we still need more time? We still have a little bit more time, so it's okay. It's okay. Take your time. I'm just wondering if anybody got the solution yet. Okay, so it seems like a couple of you guys are having some trouble with it, so don't worry. So basically what happens is that if we come back over here, we can see that there are two components within this, right? So within this column, so within this row, we have three buttons. And within these three buttons, we have a button, and inside of this button, within this one button, we have a column. And within this column, we have two widgets. So if we come back here, we've already created this button, but we want to add these widgets so that it shows up. So to create this, we create another column right here. So we create a column, and then we give it some properties, and we give it some children. So we give it some children. So this is going to be another list of widgets because we want to include two widgets, right? So I want to include two widgets. So we're going to include an icon, right? So I want to include an icon, and we can include maybe icons dot text field or something like that. And then we can also include a icon. Let's see. Yeah. Okay. Text fields. Oops. Okay. And then we can also include text. So we can include text, and we can say text. And just like that, if we update our UI now, so we press run again, we can see right over here, obviously it's not in the center, but we can see that we have created these two boxes. So if we draw the boxes again, so we have created this one box, this one big box, and then within it, we've created two widgets, just like in this one, right? We had two widgets, a text widget and icon widget. I hope that helps you guys. And we can move on. If there's any other questions, we can stop for the questions and then we can answer those. And if you guys have any errors, so far so smooth, we can stop as well. So is everything okay? Do you guys have any errors? You have errors? Okay. Why don't you share your screen, Rion? Ian, you have a bunch of errors too. Okay. Let's start with Ian. And, huh?
I can't share my screen.
Oops, sorry. Okay, let me change that. Okay, I just changed it. Sorry. Okay. So over here, it says at line 159, we require to put a What is it called? Parentheses. So put a parentheses. Maybe try before the bracket. Okay. Let's see. So let's say that. Can you scroll down to one more line? Can you go one more line down? Yeah, okay. Okay. Yeah, so I think, so the error is that we're missing. We're missing at line 159. Put that parentheses again. Yep, right before the bracket. Okay, and then see how it says it's linked up with the elevated button, and there's like a circle, right? There's a thing right there, and it's like highlighted. Yeah, perfect. Okay, so that basically means that these two are linked up. Okay, perfect. Okay, so now it says in line 161, it expects a bracket. So basically what this means is that for here, we took away the bracket from the initial column. So we need to add another bracket. Yep, perfect. And then if we put a comma, yep, just right there. Yep, perfect. And then we can press this format button right at the top right here. Is it letting you format it? I don't know. Is it saying no formatting? Okay, it's okay. Now if you try to run it, I don't know why there's still the red lines, but it's all gonna work. You can try to press format button a couple of times. Sometimes it works. And yeah, I don't know. But yeah, so now it should be working. And yep, give it a second. Is it saying anything underneath? I can't see that part. What is it? Is it saying anything?
It's like saying error compiling to JavaScript.
Oh, okay. That's not good. Okay. Then let's take a look. So what I want you to do is actually I want you to copy all of this code from here. Hello? Oh yeah. Right here. I can't see it. I don't know why. Let me get out of this annotating mode. Maybe then I'll be able to see it. Is there another error underneath? It says info right there. Is there anything underneath the info?
Yes, there's like one line 162 expecting to find like that difference.
Oh, it requires something else? Oh, yeah, not a, how do I get rid of this? I cannot see your screen. Oh, okay, wait, let me make it smaller. Okay, there we go, perfect. Okay, it says line 162. Okay, yeah, put a thing and then maybe put another one. Yep, there we go. And then now try formatting. Yep, and then now try running at the top. Perfect. Okay, I think that should work. Yeah, there we go. Okay, perfect. Okay. I'm going to stop your screen share. And then next, Ian, would you like to share your screen? Okay. So it says elevated button. Could you hide? Yeah, there we go. Perfect. Okay. The argument type elevated button cannot be assigned. List widget. So I think you're just missing. Let's see. Okay, could you click on, let me annotate this. So could you click right here? Right on the bracket, right on the bracket. Yeah, okay. So as you can see, so it's highlighting right here, and it's highlighting that's red up here as well. So this means that there's a mismatch and it's missing a bracket right here. So see how you're missing a bracket right there? Yeah, so you just want the end the start bracket. Yep. And then you want to add another, so over here you have this end bracket, but we want to start with the new bracket over there, right? Yep, and then we want to put the end bracket right here. The end one. Oh yeah, perfect, okay. And then we also want to put a comma right here. Remember, that's our syntax to include a list of things. We want to put a comma. Yep, there we go. And then you should also, it's saying that on press, there's no corresponding. So basically right now, what's happening right now is that, can you click up here on your elevated button? Yeah, so it's corresponding to the wrong parentheses. So you need another parentheses right before this bracket. So see right before that bracket. Yeah, put another parentheses and then put a comma. And then now try pressing format at the top right. Oh, you have an extra M right there. It's not going to format anything. Yeah. Yep. And then try pressing format. No formatting changes. Oh, no. Okay, let's try line 158. So line 158 says it's expecting another comma. So, I mean, another parenthesis. So why don't you put that? Another parenthesis, yep, one more. Yeah, okay. And then why don't we put our cursor right here? Yep, and then, okay, so now it's saying that the getter text of icons is not defined. Okay, so right here, it's actually text underscore fields. Yeah, and then fields with an S, yep. And then line 153, it says too many positional arguments. So can you hover right? You forgot to put the colon, the colon right there. After on press, right? So after every property, after every parameter we pass, we want to put colon. Okay. So now we see that there's just a bunch of formatting errors. So why don't we press format at the top? It's still not formatting. Okay. Okay. So why don't we come over here and we put, so can I do something really quick? Because this is going to take a little while. So can I just really quickly request remote control and do it really quickly? Okay, perfect. Yeah, let me just really quickly do this because it's taking a little bit longer. Something happened. Okay. I think now we should be able to run it and format it. Okay, there we go. Yep. Okay, next. Does anybody have any other questions? Okay, then we can proceed. And so now what I want you guys to do, so now that everyone has that code, so now what I want you guys to do is I want you guys to highlight all of this and we're going to make another copy, right? Because remember, we have three buttons. So we have three buttons. So we have one button for text and we have one button for icons and we have one button for both of them, right? So after we selected all of these and made three copies of everything, so remember to select all of these things. So to double check that you're selecting all of the parentheses and everything, what I always do right before I select anything is I hover right on top of this parentheses and see now how it's highlighting this parentheses and this parentheses This means that this is a combined pair. And this means that this is exactly what I want to highlight. And I highlighted this and I created three copies. Okay. So now if I run this, oh no, there's three text things, right? So I want to edit this and I want to maybe say add, or, and then I want to say maybe both. So we can maybe say copy as our icon and we can say both. So now if we run, we can see that we have three different icons and it says three different things. And that's about it. So so now we've created these three icons, right? But it doesn't look that great. So what we're gonna do is what I talked about briefly earlier. I talked about this really briefly, but I wanna discuss a little bit more. So within columns and rows, we have two properties of axis alignment. So an axis is going to obviously be the y-axis and x-axis, which is what we've commonly known. But in this case, the main axis alignment is going to be the horizontal. So this is main. And then this is going to be the cross axis. So the y-axis is going to be the cross axis. So it's weird, but in the case of rows, this is actually switched. So what we want to do is we want to switch this because in essentially a row is just a rotated column. So if we take all of this, so if we select all of this and we just rotate it, right? It becomes a row, okay? So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna come over here and we're gonna say, and we're gonna give this a property of cross axis alignment. And then we're gonna give it the property, and then we're gonna give it the object of cross axis alignment dot, oh wait, sorry, main axis, what am I saying? I literally described main axis alignment, and then dot, and we see how we have all these options over here. So we wanna choose the one that's maybe spaced evenly, right? Because we wanna space all of these objects evenly, okay? And then what error is this throwing? Getter children, okay. This requires a comma at the end. And then, okay, to avoid all these things, because some of you guys have been asking, I don't know, why is it showing the prefers const? It's just kind of weird and annoying. I haven't really seen that, but I guess you guys could add constant to here if you guys want to get rid of that. And then after we format everything and we run it, so we can run it. So remember, so basically what we did right now is that we add this axis alignment. And then now we can see with that one simple thing, we've changed the column from being axis aligned all the way to the left, which is the default. We've changed this to be axis aligned evenly. So it automatically determines the ratio and it automatically determines, oh, even if I move it like this and left and right, it automatically keeps all these things even, because we've added this axis alignment to this row property. Okay, and then next. So next what we're gonna be dealing with is we're gonna be working on creating this text, right? Because right now, when we do all of these things, it doesn't update. It doesn't really, you can only see the icons, right? So what we wanna do is we wanna create another variable. So we wanna create a variable called selected word. Oh no, we want to create a variable called selected tab. Sorry. So we're going to create a variable right underneath this and we're going to call this selected tab. And then for now, we're going to give this a integer and we're going to give this a property of selected tab is equal to 0. So now when we come over here, we have these three tabs, right? So we're going to be using this property.
Can you slow down a little bit? I didn't get the previous part.
Sorry. Yes, of course. Okay. So basically right now what we're doing is we're creating this integer called selected tab. So selected tab is basically so that when we change the tab, so when we change between text tab, icon tab, and if we change between the both tab, we want to change this variable to become either 0, so this is 0th property, 0, 1, and 2, right? Because we want to update this the UI accordingly. So right above here, we want to create this with all our other variables. And then now, if we scroll down over here, we can come back to the three buttons. So like I described, when we press on these three buttons, we want something to change. So what we're changing in our backend, where we're changing behind all the scenes, is we're changing the selected tab number. But to change the selected tab number, remember what we said about stateless and stateful widgets? We also need to change the state of our widgets, because this is obviously going to be a stateful widget that we're updating between the icon and the text. So we're going to use a property called setState. And remember this method from last time? So we're going to use this and we're going to update the state of selected tab. So we're going to say selected tab is equal to zero, because this is the first, the zeroth index of our three list variables. So now if we can use this exact same idea and we can do it for all the other variables, I mean, all the other tabs. So we can do this as both, which is two, and then we can do the icons, which is one. And now after we've updated all of this, I hope you guys maybe got that down. I'll just stop. I'll pause right here for you guys to copy the code. But that's basically what we're doing. So I just copy and pasted this into the other onPress functions. I'll get a sip of water. But yeah, so after completing this setState function, what we're going to do now is we're going to come up to the top right here, and we're going to edit this main part. Because right now when we update this, nothing really is changing, but in the back end, all this stuff is changing. So this integer is actually changing, but the UI is not reflecting, which is why we're going to change this to a row. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a row up here. So this row is going to have two properties. So we're going to put the children, and then we're going to give it a list of widgets, right? And then within this list of widgets, what do we need? We want a text and we want an icon. So we already have our icon, but we just want our text. So we can just command and we can copy this up here. And
wait, I don't get this step. Can you slow down a little?
Yeah, sure. So basically, let me share you my other screen. So if we come back over here, we can see that there is going to be this other, there's going to be both, right? So when we press both of these things are going to be in the same row. So we've created a row. So that's exactly what we've done right here. So right here, if we draw it out, we can see that right here, there's a row. So within this row, there are two widgets. So these two widgets, but when we don't have the row, we only have one widget, which is why we need to keep updating the UI. And I'm going to keep teach you guys how to do that right now. So I hope that makes a little bit more sense, maybe, because I need to keep going. I'm sorry. We only have 10 more minutes of class, so I need to keep going. I can't flow over. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you. So we're going to create a row, and within this row, we're going to have two functions. So we're going to have the text. So we can put the text right here. We can say text. And then we can pass in a text. So right now, we can just pass in text as a basic text right now, right? And obviously, we can style this later to whatever colors and whatever things we want. We've already discussed styling, so I hope you guys can do that by yourself. And then after that, now if we run this right now, we can see that. The text and everything is over here off the right, but we remember how to fix this. It's simply by changing the axis alignment. So we want to change that main axis alignment. And we want to make this to main axis alignment dot space evenly. Up space evenly. And once we do that, we can see how it's really updated and we can really see the great change that it has. Okay. And next, what we're going to do next is we are going to make it so that when we press on one of these, so if we press on text or if we press on icons, we want to update it to get rid of the other one, right? Because we don't really want both of the, sorry, we don't really want both of the things at all time. So how we can do this is utilizing a function called, utilizing something that we can make, that we can show the widget or we don't show the widget. So to do this, we are gonna use, we're gonna wrap everything. So we're gonna press, we're gonna copy everything. So, or we can right click, I don't know what the command is on. So if we come over here, there's a keyboard shortcuts. This is really complicated, but we want to do something called quick fix. So quick fix. So everyone look for their keyboard shortcut called quick fix. So quick fix will show us a variety of different things. So when I press my quick fix function, it shows us this wrap with widget. So when we wrap this with the widget.
Wait, how do you get to the keyboard shortcuts?
You just press right here. This keyboard button at the bottom. At the bottom left, there's a keyboard button. And then right here, I'm not sure what the quick fix button is for Windows. Maybe it's Control Enter. But on Mac, it's going to be Option Enter. And then over here, we can use quick fix. So what I did was I used quick fix. So I use a quick fix button. And it shows us this list of things that we can do. So what I want you guys to do is I want you guys to select the first option, which is wrap with widget. So we wrap this with the widget. We can use this and we can say, we want to wrap it with a visibility widget. So we can say visibility. And then what we want to say is we want to pass in a property called visible. Visible will make sure that this widget is only visible if and only if the visibility is, I mean, this visibility is true. So basically what happens is now we want to make sure that we don't want to show the text when the icons are selected. So how can we do this? We make sure that the selected tab, if the selected tab is equal to 1. So we show this if the selected tab is equal to 1. Or, this is the OR function, if selected tab. So if the selected tab is equal to 2. Because basically we only want to show this widget if the icons is, if text is selected. So if text is selected or if both is selected. So the same thing goes over here. So we can say wrap with widget and we can say visibility. And we can do the same thing. So underscore selected tab is equal to 1 because we only want the icon when 1 is selected, or we want the icon when 2 is selected. So this is, remember, this is 0. So let me write it over here. So this is going to be 0, 1, and 2, right? I remember in the buttons when we push them, we set them to equal 0, 1, and 2. So this is how it's going to be working right now. So if we press run again, let's take a look at what happens. Oh my gosh, the other one has disappeared because now the default thing is 0. So if we press icons, the icon appears. And if we press both of them are appearing. So this is a beauty that we can use with Flutter and use different widgets. And especially the visibility widget is a great widget to use to hide certain widgets. So next we're gonna be altering the random icon. So when we press random icon, it's only changing their icon. But what we wanna really do is update both of them. So up here, if we scroll all the way to the top, remember how we talked about lists? So up here, even in the last class, you guys didn't even know this, but there was already a list and we've been using that list. So in this class, we're gonna be creating a list of words. So we're going to be using the same thing and we're using the same idea of having all of these lists of different icons and we're going to be adding our own words. So I want you guys to add like approximately 3 to 5 words in this. Maybe 5 is better, so it'll become like a little bit more random. So I'll just add like things that are around me, like bottle, phone. And remember to add a comma after each thing. So computer, maybe fan and headphones. So I just added 5 things for now. You can obviously keep altering this and add more things. I hope you guys do. And then after this, what we want to do is we want to come down here and we want to do the exact, so on this random icon, remember on this random icon, we had this huge method for onTap. So when you push the random icon, this would start rolling. But now what we're going to do is we're going to set the state of another variable. So we're going to set the state of a variable that we have to create up here. So just like the random icon, how we selected a random icon. So remember underscore selected icon. We selected a random icon and we want to create a string called underscore selected text. So we can say text, initial text is text or something like that, right? And once we do that, we want to come over here and we want to say we want to pass in underscore selected text. Remember how over here we passed in underscore selected icon? This allows this to become a stateless widget and allows it to keep updating as the variable selected text is updated. So now when we update the variable selected text, when we press random icon, so over here, if we come over here and we say selected text is equal to list of words, and then we use a random property again. So random next int, and then we say list of words dot length. And if we end all of that off, it's really long, but if we end all of this off and we run this, I'm going too fast. I'm sorry. I have two more minutes. So don't worry, guys. So basically what's going to happen now is because it's too fast for most of you guys and it's too complex right now, I'm just going to carry this over to next class. So we'll start off with this. And I want all of you guys to save your code. So what I'm going to show you guys is how to save your code right now, because it's more complex than I imagined for you guys. So don't worry, it's okay. It's all good. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to this website called gist.github. I hope all of you guys have a GitHub account. Of course I can share the solution code. The solution code will be posted at 4:30 to the Google Classroom. Over here, if we go to gist.github, I hope all of you guys follow the instructions and create a gist GitHub account. If we go to gist.github, we can come over here and we can say main.dart. And over here, we can select all of this code and we can save it in our gist. So over here, I've saved all of this code. And then I want you guys to create this gist and save it. We want to save this as maybe class 3. I'm going to say main.dart as our file. And then over here, it'll automatically give you some colors and stuff like that. And this is too fast. I'm so sorry. I don't have that much time left, but this is how you save your code. I hope you guys go over here to gist.github, or you guys can save it on like a Google Docs or something like that. And then through that, you guys can access it later and copy it into the thing. So once I create this, I can go back and I can access this whenever, and I can copy this back to the Dart pad, and through Dart pad, I can run it and keep editing it. And I hope you guys save this for next time, because we'll be working on it next time, okay? I'm so sorry, guys. This is like really, really fast and there's a lot of information today, but I hope you guys understood and we worked on, and everything will be on Google Classroom. So if you guys check over there, there'll be the starter code, the finished code, and everything is gonna be uploaded, even the presentation. So hope you guys check that out. Save your code for next time and I'll see you guys next week. I'm sorry, I was too fast today. Okay, bye.
I think we're going to wait a couple of minutes to let more participants arrive. Okay, I think we're going to start now. Let me start sharing my screen. So this is the third week of the LEGO Robotics Bootcamp, and last week we went a little bit into robot strategy and a little bit of design, but today we're going to go a lot more in depth into more robot design strategies and things you should keep in mind. So the first tip that we want to give you is to build your robot in rectangles. So this means to build your robot without slanted pieces, and this would allow for a lot more stability for your robot. And if your robot is built with like more angled or rounded pieces, it's just going to be a lot more unstable, and your robot could fall apart a lot more easily. So a really good way to test if your robot is stable and to test if like it can stay together is to kind of toss your robot onto a like a springed mattress. And if the pieces are like stay together, then your design is efficient and it'll stay together. And if it doesn't stay in one piece, then you should try to redesign your robot and reinforce it.
So tip two is to invert the larger motors, and this will allow for more space underneath the robot, and it'll also help keep the motors farther off the ground. And this essentially will create a compact and tighter robot, which will lead to one of the more stable robots. However, using the inverted motors requires changes in programming. So going forward will make the robot go backwards, but you can use gears to fix this.
So the third tip is to make sure all your wires are coiled and neatly put together on your robot. And this tip is really important because if your wires aren't neat and organized, then there's a higher chance that your wheels or any part of your robot can get stuck on the wires. And it can also get stuck in the gears on your robot. And if this happened, like if your robot gets stuck on the wires, this can also lead to your mat getting ruined. So just, even though it doesn't really, it's just kind of an important thing to keep in mind so that your design stays organized.
And the fourth tip is putting color sensors in front. And this will allow you to line up your robot exactly on the colored lines, and that will help your robot know where the lines are on the mat. And it's important for your robot to be in the right position, but obviously during matches, sometimes a turn can go wrong. So in your programs, make sure to anticipate that there will be something that goes wrong in the code. And color sensors kind of help you overcome this because the features on the mat, like the colored lines and walls, help you start your robot and make sure that it's always in the right position when you're carrying out the missions.
The fifth tip is to use tall wheels. The taller your wheels are, the more durable they are and the less space they'll take up. And this will allow your robot to move and maneuver into smaller and tighter areas. And also the thinner your attachments are, the more compact your robot is. Tall wheels can be mounted up high, but they can also make contact with the ground. And this taller wheels also, one rotation results in like your robot moving a farther distance than a shorter wheel. And then a shorter wheel will also require you to make more rotations to cover the same amount of distance. And this increases the margin of error. So taller wheels can also help your robot stay on course and stay accurate.
So adding on to the idea of wheels, these Lego motorcycle wheels best used for your robot because they are tall and thin, which will save you a lot of space. And they also have a slick tread pattern, and this and it's better than having the knobby tread pattern because it can cause a lot of vibration, which will end up causing the robot to drive off course. And some advantages with these wheels are that it helps to make the robot more compact. The robot can drive faster because the wheel is larger, and taller wheels can travel a greater distance than smaller wheels. And you want something like this since the FLL match is only gonna be 2.5 minutes. So the less time you spend on traveling to missions, the better. There are some disadvantages with these wheels, and there's just less work. There's not a lot of power, but this isn't a big deal.
So the sixth tip is to use a proper rear wheel. And one of the rear wheels that is pretty common among most FLL robots is a ball wheel. And this makes sure that your robot doesn't get stuck on the mat, and make sure that your robot doesn't have any extra drag. And extra drag can lead your robot to become inconsistent, and it can lead to failure on the mat. Large rear wheels are kind of the most, probably not like the best idea, not the best thing to use for your robot, because they slide around on the mat and add friction. And an omnidirectional wheel, like the ball bearing in this picture, is probably the best rear wheel to use.
So it's okay to use the smaller wheels on the back of your robot since they don't have, or they don't add as much drag or friction. And we would recommend you guys use the ball wheel. And yeah, because that will help cause less drag. And some people also like to add skis or skids on the back, and you can do this by the flat pieces. And then this does work, but we would recommend the ball wheels.
You also want to make sure that your center of gravity is good. With a small robot, it's easier to center the EV3 to provide like a good center of gravity. If you don't have a good center of gravity, your robot can lose traction on the mat, especially if your robot stops to do another action. So for instance, if you want your robot to go forward, stop, and then turn, if you don't have a good center of gravity, then your robot can lose traction. So you also want to try to make sure that your robot is balanced in the middle. So this would be like by adding equal amounts of weight on each side of the robot. These would just be kind of main tips to ensure that your center of gravity is proper.
So here are some questions to consider while designing and creating your robot. And these are around building the base of your robot. And the first question is, what is the perfect size for your robot to help keep all the construction balanced? Second question is, what tires do you guys want to use for the robot? And third question is, where and how shall we put the sensors and attachments?
So for the size of your robot, you will need to make sure that your robot is within the limitations and requirements of the guidelines that are given to you. So the first main limitation is, or requirement is that your robot and all of the attachments that come with it fit inside the base on the mat. And we will talk about this in the next slide. And then your robot must be under 12 inches. The size limitation, the last bullet, might vary each year. Sometimes in the past it has been 16 inches, but in recent seasons the requirement for your robot has been under 12 inches. So it just depends on what the rule book says.
So something to keep in mind is that the shape of the base may change. Last couple of seasons, the base was shaped as like a quarter of a circle, which is seen in the left picture. But the base has also been a square shape.
So to continue on with talking about the correct size of, or like the right size of your robot, is making sure that you look at the mat for the season, for the challenge that season, and looking at the dimensions of the base, and making sure that your robot and all the attachments can fit in the base, but making sure that there is a little bit of extra space like in the base after adding your robot and attachments. And you should also keep in mind that bigger isn't better, except for when you're talking about wheels. The bigger your robot is doesn't necessarily mean it can move faster, or it can complete missions faster, or like get you the most points. So it's always better to keep your robot more compact, And the less pieces your robot utilizes and the more compact it is, the more sturdier your robot will end up being.
So like we mentioned earlier, the wheels you use the better. So you want your wheels to be tall and thin so that your robot can remain compact. And you also want to have durable tires to ensure that your robot is consistent. And if one tire is flatter than the other, then your robot will tend to veer one way or another or go off course, because the flatter tire would supposedly make the wheel smaller than the other. So it's important that you guys use the same size wheels and keep in mind how you want to make your robot consistent and compact.
For attachment and sensor placement, the ideal placement for them would be to put them all in one area of your robot and in the front. This would make it a lot easier during your match to switch out attachments, so you don't have to waste time like rotating your robot or placing things all over the place in the base. You also want only one connection point. On the front of your robot, make space for where the motors can connect to your brick, and where your attachments can also connect. And you might want to search up different types of attachment systems online. YouTube and like online forums are a great place to find ideas to solve any problems you might have. So one attachment system is like dog gears, which is basically like a two-part clutch, and it connects two shafts. The slideshow will be on like a Google Doc, so if you want to look at any YouTube videos that we've linked in like speaker notes, then you can do that. And then for the last bullet, sensors can be placed anywhere on your robot depending on what type of sensor they are. So we talked about color sensors. You would want to place at the front of your robot so that it's easier for your robot to sense lines along the mat. So it just depends on what type of sensors you're using and what they're going to be used for. And so this is just like a quick time lapse of someone making a Lego Mindstorms robot. It's pretty short, and it'll just kind of give you an idea of how simple your robot design can be. So in the video, you could see like pretty basic attachments being used. At the end, they put in the ball, which we had talked about in one of the previous slides. But you also could see that the creator was utilizing different attachments that they were given in the Lego Mindstorms like box you're given with all the attachments. But yeah, it's just, it's really like a good idea to utilize all the attachments you're given to solve any problems that you're having. And that's our last slide. So are there any questions we can answer? Okay, so next week we will be kind of discussing the basics of robot software and just like how to program like basic movements for your robot and basic code for any sensors you might want to use. But that's about it. If anyone has any questions, you can, I can put our emails in the chat and you can just let us know if you have any questions. But that's about it. Diksha, if you want to put yours. And this recording will also be posted on the Google Doc that's shared to all of the registered participants. And yeah, so that's it. Have a great week and we'll see you next Sunday.